Separation anxiety is one of the most heartbreaking behaviors that any dog owner can have to deal with their dogs. And in this video, I'm going to teach you how to not only avoid separation anxiety happening in the first place, but if you are struggling with a dog with separation anxiety, how a foolproof method of fixing separation anxiety once it sets in. Welcome back to Will and Mabel. If you are new here, my name's Will. I'm a canine behaviorist from FenrirDogTraining.com. And on this channel, I help people not only choose the right breed for them, but how to become excellent canine leaders that are able to raise perfect canine companions to help my mission of stopping dogs ending up in shelters and unfortunately euthanized. So if you are new here and you want more dog training or puppy training or canine behavior tips and advice, hit that subscribe button so you never miss a future upload. Now, before we dive into everything that you need to know about separation anxiety, if you didn't see the little comment I put on my channel over the weekend, I have launched a brand new channel called Will and Sully. If you didn't know, if you are new here, this channel, Will and Mabel, was dedicated to me raising my Connie Corso puppy Mabel from the day I brought her home up to hopefully a perfect canine companion so that you guys could follow along with that journey. Now, unfortunately, she did pass away at just 4 months age from a hereditary heart issue called PDA. Now, what we've decided to do is we're going to, in her memory, keep this channel alive and turn it into a dedicated dog training channel. Problem with that is a lot of you guys were missing kind of the vlog type content, and in those vlogs where I was discussing me training my new puppy, you guys got to see my Labrador Sully a lot more. So not only did you miss the vlog type content where you saw me kind of day to day and behind the scenes of a lot of the stuff that I do as a canine educator and behaviorist and working online and here on YouTube and all that good stuff, but also you were really interested in learning more about Sully. So if you want to see that channel, new channel, it's called Will and Sully. The link's in the description box. So if you want to know more about Labradors and see more vlog and behind the scenes type content, that's the channel for that. This channel is going to stay dedicated to dog training. Like I say, if you're interested, go check it out. But that's enough waffling. Let's get back onto the topic of separation anxiety, because I know that if you are struggling with separation anxiety, it is absolutely heartbreaking for owners to deal with. And I really want to get into some more higher level theory here and really help you guys get over this problem. And before we start, I really want you to rest assured that as a canine behaviorist, separation anxiety is one of the more difficult challenges. And when I get asks for consultation or to work with a separation anxiety case, it is something that is like, okay, time to get your game face on situation. But it is also one of the problem behaviors that has the absolute highest conversion rate for successful rehabilitation. So if you are struggling with it and you're upset and you've got neighbors that are getting angry with you, or you're getting home and you're seeing your dog covered in urine or fecal matter or hurting themselves, and it's absolutely devastating for you, I promise you we're going to be able to get you over this. And the very first thing we need to do, and the first thing that I always do when I'm working with any kind of separation anxiety cases, is determine, is it actually separation anxiety? Because separation anxiety is a term that is thrown around a lot, and it's unnecessarily thrown around a lot. Separation anxiety, the best way to describe it is like someone that has a genuine phobia, not just a fear, not just a I don't really like that thing, but a true phobia that causes severe fear, severe panic attacks, and severe anxiety. That's what separation is with a dog, when that they truly have a phobia of being left on their own. If your dog is crying or whining, that often isn't separation anxiety and is more a learnt behavior for them getting what they want. So oftentimes we have to decide, is it alert behavior or is it true separation anxiety? Because based on which one of those things it is decides how we move forward with fixing that problem. So how do you know if it is true separation anxiety? Well, separation anxiety obviously comes when the dog is being separated and left on their own. Now, if the dog is just crying or barking, that doesn't necessarily make for separation anxiety. What I would be looking for is a few things. Does the dog instantly defecate or urinate when left on their own? Obviously, as long as they've had chance to go for a walk and do it naturally. If they just needed the toilet and went, or they're a very young puppy and can't hold their bladder or their tummies for that amount of time, and they have accidents, that doesn't mean, but if the dog is older, or you know for a fact that they've been out to the toilet and they don't actually need to go to the toilet, and they are consistently defecating and urinating, that is a very common warning sign of separation anxiety. If they are extremely destructive when you leave them, especially at the point in which you leave them, so a dog, again, people need to understand, very binary, it's very black and white and one and zero. So if you walk through a door, that door is often then the target zone of that separation anxiety, and it will be very common for the dog to destroy that door frame, to destroy the door, to be scratching and clawing at that door, maybe the window. If they watch you leave, can then often be the target zone for that level of destruction. And it's not necessarily a destructive behavior in terms of how, like, a Labrador might have excessive chewing behaviors, but it's an attempt to break out kind of destructive behavior. So that's another warning sign. And then a very big one is if the dog, in that attempt of through either fear of getting out of a crate or a pen, if that's where they're being held, or out of a room, if they're hurting themselves. Again, a dog that doesn't have separation anxiety won't take it to the point where they're making their paws bleed, or they're trying to squeeze through small spaces and cutting themselves, or giving themselves severe friction burns. Those types of things are what I would be looking for severe separation anxiety. If it's simply whining or crying or barking, that for me is much often more a case of a learnt behaviour, and we're going to discuss the two things now. Now we'll start with the learnt behaviour. 95% of the, when I initially get come to for separation anxiety, and then we go through a bit of a consultation about, well, what actually is it? 95% of the time it's definitely more a learnt behavior. And when we discuss a learnt behavior, what I mean is that the dog has very much learnt that by displaying those irritating behaviors of crying or barking or whining, that they get what they want, which is to be let out of either the crate, or to be able to come up onto the bed, or to be able to sleep in your bedroom, those kind of examples. So in terms of a preemptive stopping of those things happening, you absolutely must never give in to that crying or barking. And if you are disciplined, it very rarely takes more than 2 days for the dog to realize, oh, if I cry or I bark or I yap or any of those other annoying behaviors, I don't get what I want, so I might as well just settle down and chill. Now, to help them settle down and chill, I often use, it's very much a positive method and approach to doing this, frozen Kongs are your best friend when it comes to these kind of behaviors. Get a Kong, stuff it full of meat pate, or I'm not usually a big fan of peanut butter, maybe if you get the natural stuff that's not full of sugar, but we're not going to have that conversation now. I like meat pate. It's really cheap, it's just blended up meat. Dog love it more than peanut butter, in my opinion. Stuff it in, chuck it in the freezer so it's frozen. Then whenever you're leaving the dog, wherever you're leaving them, let them sniff the frozen Kong first. And if you're putting them in a crate, for example, let them smell it. Put the Kong in the crate and shut the door on the crate, and don't let the dog go in immediately. Build up that, like, I want to get in there, I want to go in there, I want to go in there. Then just before you leave, you let the dog in, shut the door, and then leave quietly, calmly, don't make a fuss. And you'll build up that association with, hurry up, mate, bugger off, I want you to leave, because when you leave, I get to go in there and get that amazing thing. And you're creating a positive association with the fact that you're leaving, and that them being on their own is a good thing, because they get access to this Kong. If you're leaving them in a pen, same thing applies. If you're leaving them in a room, it's a little bit more difficult, because you don't necessarily just want to shut them behind a door, because then they can't smell and get excited. But you definitely could still do it. Let them smell it, chuck the Kong in the floor in the room that you're going to leave them on, and shut the door. And you'll often find that the dog will then sit and stay and wait to get in. And again, just before you leave, you open them up, you shut the door dead calmly, dead quietly, don't make a fuss, leave. And again, the dog will very quickly associate that being on their own is cool, because they get the best thing in the world. And if you only ever give them access to that frozen Kong for that, and that is their number one most excitable treat in the world, job's a good one, problem solved, you've done it preemptively. And again, just don't give in to them. When you come home, don't make a fuss, stay calm, stay relaxed, wait for calm behavior, reinforce calm behavior, never reinforce excitable behavior. Don't come home and go, oh, hey buddy, I'm so mischief, you miss me, ooh. Because again, you're creating an association that they need to be fearful about you going and coming. You need to create that positive association that everything needs to be calm and relaxed, and you coming and going isn't a big deal. It's calm, it's relaxed. Dogs like calm, consistent leaders. You're hitting the calm there, you're hitting the consistency, and you're just naturally a leader through all the other areas that I discuss in my online courses over on FedNarayDogTraining.com. So that's my number one thing for preemptive. you've got a dog that's doing those alert behaviours, do exactly the same process, frozen Kong, if they do start crying, there's a few little ways you can do it. First of all, you could stand behind the door, and when they start crying, you can give them a firm verbal correction, and then get them to calm down, wait for the calm. When they're calm and quiet, you then wait for 5 seconds, you open the door and go in. Repeat the process again. Once they're calm and quiet, wait for 10 seconds, go back in, open the door. 15 seconds, go back in. 30 seconds, a minute, a couple of minutes, and then you can go out and you just build it up slowly. But again, if you remove everything to a calm level, you never give in to the barking or yapping, go to your neighbours, give them a box of chocolates and say, I've got a dog, he's being a bit obnoxious, it's going to take me a couple of days to get over the barking, I'm really sorry, I'm going to do it during the day, hopefully when you're at work, but if you are in, I'm really sorry, here's a box of chocolates, I need to get over it so that long term we can have a quiet and calm dog. If you're proactive with that rather than waiting for your neighbours to get really angry and annoyed, you'll probably find they go, oh, nice one, mate, yeah, don't worry about it, it's cool. And you can just be preemptive and proactive about solving those issues. So that's kind of the learnt behaviour. It's not rocket science. If you really want to learn more about how dogs learn, and that's very much around operant conditioning, of how dogs inadvertently learn bad behaviours, because that is the most common way that dogs learn these obnoxious, annoying behaviours. You're not doing it on purpose, of course you're not, but you're just not aware that you're teaching your dog those bad behaviours. So one of the best things you can do, in my opinion, is put your dog through my boot camp course. Again, the link is in the description box for that. You can go check it out. It's not a hard sell, but if it sounds like it's your cup of tea and you want to know more information, we do real deep dive into the operant conditioning and learning theory of how canines learn. And once you kind of understand that, you'll then start to notice those times where you're going, oh, this is where I'm cocking up. I'm teaching the dog to do this annoying thing that I didn't realize I was doing before. And that is where these learnt behaviors around separation anxiety or aggression or jumping up or the very common, more minor behavioral problems come from, is you inadvertently reinforcing negative behaviors, and you need to kind of flip the script. And that's what my boot camp teaches you to do. But like I say, I want to get into the separation anxiety now. Severe, genuine separation anxiety. When you get to this stage, this is where I restructure usually 1 to 3 month modification program. And again, I know a lot of you are going to go, oh, okay, well, it isn't a learned behavior. I actually do think I've got a case of severe separation anxiety here. For me to tell you this is going to be a 1 to 3 month program, you're going to go, oh, no way, you're kidding me, Will. But like I say, if you go through that program and how I go about it, it's got a very, very high, almost 100% success rate. And it's about a behavior remodification program alongside a desensitization program. What that means is that we're going to modify the behavior. So we're going to teach the behavior that is the separation anxiety. We're going to modify that and change it into the desired behavior that we want, alongside a desensitization program, which is where we're going to desensitize the triggers for that problem behavior. You do those things alongside each other and we're going to move forward. Now, the problem with these kind of programs is that if you work and you have to go out of your house 8 hours a day, it can be much more of a difficult process than if you could be with your dog 24/7 and help them through step by step. Because obviously, if you're with them 24/7, we can start with 1 second breaks and build it up and never let the dog get to a failure point. Whereas if you're going out for 8 hours a day for work, you're going to set your dog up to fail every single day, which is going to delay the process much more than if you could be with them. So my advice is to save up some money, put your dog into a doggy daycare every single day throughout the time that we're doing this modification program, so that your dog is never alone and we never allow them to have that fear of being left on their own. It's all about what I talk about, setting our dogs up for success. Don't set them up to failure. And in separation anxiety, that can be very hard. So either get someone, pay somebody to come and sit in at your house. Oftentimes students might do that, your neighbors might do it. Depending on where you are, again, it might cost you a little bit of money to get a dog sitter to come and sit in. But like I say, if you've got true separation anxiety, your dog needs it ultimately, because like I say, this isn't just an obnoxious, annoying behaviour, it's a severe phobia that is crushing your dog's spirit every single time you go out. So my advice, make sure, right, I'm going to start from the first of next month, we're going to do it, and it's going to, for that entire month, we're going to get them into a doggy daycare, pay the money for that 1 month, and then we're going to work on this modification and desensitisation programme when we are at home and we can control the variables. So that's my first advice for that. So then you've made that decision, you're doing that, excellent, we're setting our dogs up for success, and we're going to go through, this is quite complex theory and I want it to be more in layman's terms so that you can understand it. If you really, really struggle with this and you've decided you've got severe separation anxiety and you feel like this is a little bit above your skill set, then I recommend you finding a local canine behaviourist, not a trainer. This definitely fits into the behaviour and psychology because it is a psychological issue, not just a training issue, that someone that can really come and help you with a modification and desensitisation programme and guide you through the process step by step. But if you've got a good all-round knowledge of dogs and you can follow along with this video, it can be done without having to spend a fortune on a canine behaviourist. So we'll start with the desensitisation programme. Now, dogs will 100% have triggers for you leaving them. You might not be aware of it, and now you need to start looking for them. Very common ones: picking your keys up, jingling your keys. You only ever pick your keys up when you're about to leave. He picks his keys up, holy moly, the guy's going, he's leaving me, I'm gonna die. Anxiety sets in, panic. So desensitization around the keys, shoelaces, putting your shoes on, putting your coat on, picking up your briefcase, picking up your bag, those kind of things. You need to be aware of the triggers that are causing the separation anxiety. Once you're aware of those triggers, you can then start to desensitize those triggers. Use the analogy of the set of keys. When you're at home and you're on your sofa, get the set of keys, have them by the sofa, dog's there, pick up the keys and jingle them. You'll notice that that will start to trigger the behaviour. Pick them up, jingle them, put them back down, don't move. Do that again, don't move. Do it again, don't move. The second you pick the keys up and you jingle them and you notice that your dog doesn't, again, we're being calm throughout this entire process, and your dog doesn't start to freak out, reward, praise. Verbal praise with a little bit of a treat. This is all very positive. There's no correction involved with treating severe separation anxiety. You can correct your way out of obnoxious learnt behaviours, but not with separation anxiety. We need to use a positive based approach to this. Desensitise, same thing with your shoes on. Again, it might seem ridiculous, but when you're watching TV, put your shoes on, sit and watch TV for a few minutes, take them off, put them back on. We're desensitizing the triggers so that those things don't always mean he's going, time to panic. That way, because if you do those things and that trigger hits before you can start the behavior modification side of the program, you won't even get that far because your dog will go into panic mode before you can go into the modification program. So we need to desensitize all these triggers. Again, desensitizing them is exactly what it sounds like on the tin. Might seem ridiculous, but you might need to, again, while you're at home with your dog and you know you're not going anywhere, stand up, put your coat on, put your bag on, stand in the room for 2 seconds, take your coat off, take your bag off, put them down and sit back down. And the dog will start to understand that, oh, doesn't mean he's going every time. No need to worry. Maybe he does, maybe he doesn't. Maybe he does, maybe he doesn't. We'll wait and see. Again, we're bringing that anxiety and that fear level down around those triggers so that when you do go, we've got opportunity to work on our modification program. So now when we do go, what we need to do, again, using our frozen Kong, using a real bone, whatever your dog absolutely loves, their favorite thing in the whole planet, you guys know what it is, much more than I do, because every dog's different. It might be a certain toy, it might be a certain type of food, it might be a certain treat like a frozen Kong. I find a meat pate filled frozen Kong is definitely a place to start. If you don't really know, there's not a dog on the planet that won't like one of those highly. You never allow them access to whatever their favorite thing is. You remove it completely unless we're working on this modification program. Again, it kind of is a bit of a Venn diagram with desensitizing. So not only are we desensitizing the trigger, but then we're also gonna desensitize the leave-in by replacing that leave-in with something of real high value. But you've got to understand that because this is a phobia in the dog, that thing that is extremely high value has to be able to come close, if not better, that phobia. But if you've got a phobia of anything, you'll know, say you've got a severe severe phobia of spiders just because you love a slice of pizza. If there's a spider on your shoulder and someone gives you a piece of pizza, are you going to say, oh, cool, I don't mind about that spider because now I've got the pizza? That's how a dog's mind works when it comes to true separation anxiety. Even the best thing in the world, once the phobia kicks in, isn't going to stop them from having that phobia. So this is why we have to take things extremely slowly. And the way we do that is, once we've started to desensitize the objects, we then want to associate those triggers with the positivity-based high-value reward. Again, this is a bit of a slow process, and this is why it takes a month or two, because the desensitizing program might take a couple of weeks. Then the associative program, before we go into the modification, we're stepping into the modification now. This might take another few weeks, and then we'll discuss what you do after that. So now we've desensitized the triggers. Now we're going to swap those triggers to associate those triggers with a positive thing, as opposed to fear, phobia, separation, panic. Pick up your keys, jingle them. Dog perks his ears up and goes, are you going to go or not? I'm not sure. You've been doing this thing the last couple of weeks where sometimes you go, sometimes you don't. I'm not sure. Jingle the keys. Boom. There you go. There's a conch. And they'll not only go, are you going to go? Oh, you're not going. And cool. Nice one, mate. Let them have it for 5 minutes and then remove the thing away. Put it away. Leave it an hour. Do it again with your shoes. Do it again with putting your bag on. Whatever you've decided the triggers are for your dog's separation anxiety, we've desensitized those triggers, and now we're reassociating those triggers to an extremely high value reward. Cool, we've done that, excellent. You've spent a couple of weeks reassociating those triggers. Now, during the reassociation program, you're gonna leave that room for 1 second, and I mean 1 second. So wherever you want your dog to stay long term, now this might be a good idea to change where it has been that the dog has associated the phobia of being left on their own. So if you used to leave them in the kitchen, maybe let's try again in the living room of a fresh new environment that doesn't necessarily have those negative connotations and associations. So we're going to move to the living room. You're going to pick your keys up, whatever the triggers are, put your shoes on, put your bag on, jingle your keys. They're going to give them the conch. Now they're going to go, oh, awesome. You're going to stand up, you're going to leave the door, you're going to shut the door for 1 second, and you're going to walk straight back in, take your stuff off, sit down, let them work on their treat for a few minutes, take it away, done. That's that done for that session. You might do that 2 or 3 times a day for 1 second. And what you want to achieve is reassociating that trigger of you actually leaving to not being the end of the world. Hopefully, they're going to stay distracted by the high value reward. You leaving the door will probably make them go, and then you walk straight back in. And they'll go, oh, okay, cool. Well, when those triggers happen, I get this really cool thing. And when I get this really cool thing, it goes but comes straight back in. So I don't really need to panic. Once you've repeated that process over and over again for a week or two of 1 second, and your dog will hopefully start to not panic at that 1 second, we're literally gonna go to 2. And then we're gonna go to 3. And then we're gonna go to 5. And then we're gonna go back down to 1. But then we're gonna go back up to 10. Then back down to 5, then up to 20, then back down to 1, then 5, then 1, then 30, then 5, then 10, then 20, then a minute, then 1. You see what I'm doing? So we're doing up and down and up, but in general, we're going in the right direction over the space of a month or so, very slowly. If at any point, at 30 seconds, your dog is okay, but at 45 he starts to freak out, well then we're gonna drop it back down and we're gonna go 30 to 35, to 40 to 10, to 20 to 45. Did we get there? Awesome. Back down to 1, back to 5, 45. Did he do it again? Yes, awesome. Let's go to 50. Oh, amazing, we made it past 50. You have to be flexible, and we're really, that's where we've desensitized the triggers, we've reassociated the triggers with a positive experience, and we're leaving that positive experience with them for a set amount of time that is you leaving. Then you come back, you let them have it for a little bit longer so that you're not associating you coming home with the removal of the high value reward. You come home and they carry on working on it, and then you remove it. So it's a different association. Does that make sense? Over time, we're building up that space, and you will, I promise you, some dogs can get over separation anxiety with a week and can make those jumps quite quickly. Some it takes a couple of months, but this is where it's true canine behavior remodification and psychology. It's not simply teaching a dog to sit. It's quite a developed skill set, but it does, if you followed with what I've just said, it does make sense. I'm sure you'll agree. And it isn't rocket science. It just takes a bit of finesse and a bit of understanding of what it is that you're doing. And I hope that explained it. If it did and you enjoyed it, make sure you hit the thumbs up button. If you've got any additional questions around separation anxiety, drop them in the comment section below, or you can email me on canineshowquestions@gmail.com. More than happy to give you a more detailed answer via email than I can do just in the comment section below. But if you're really struggling with this and that sounded like I can't do that, like I say, find the local behaviorist or psychologist that can come and really break that down and do it for you for the first few sessions and teach you and show you what they're doing as you progress through that kind of modification program. Hope you enjoyed it. If you did, thumbs up, subscribe if you're new, and I'll see you on the next episode of Will and Mabel.